have fucked up a bit. It's not the end of the world, but still, it's the first time it's ever happened to me, so I think it's a bit justified. So everyone else had pulled forward without me, so already I knew that I kind of had to catch up. I hop into the ambulance, turn the little key to convoy, say to her, please, please, I know I'm not dad, but please, just for me, put her into gear and attempt to pull off. Clunk. A moment of quiet. Her engine revs, but there's no movement at all. I hop out, give her a quick bonnet hug, and probably looking like a bit of a weirdo to anyone else around me, I go, please, please, any day but today, please, little ambulance, please. Hop back in and give her another go. Still nothing. At this point, I start to panic. She's never done this to me before, and I think I'm allowed to be a bit worried. Try again. Still nothing. Now is when I'm properly panicking. She's 5 times older than any of the cars that my friends have, and she's been spoken about going for a little while, and I don't want to be the reason that she's gone. Everything okay? I hear over the PA. No, father, it's not. A Jago Jeep comes back from where they were in the line to get into the arena and asks if there's anything they can do. No, there's not. Dad comes running back across the field from the PA station, hops in, gives her a go. Still nothing. I'm in floods, absolute floods. He gives me a quick hug, rare, before running back across the field to the PA station. The Land Rover on the other side of ours looks across at me and says, they're hardy creatures. I'm sure she's fixable. I don't know how we'll get her out of this hole. Out of this hole that had been left by something. It's impossible to tell what was here as compared to now. I'd heard from some of the boys we'd encountered that it was a mess out here, but you never really know what is an exaggeration in what they tell you. We don't really talk about what happens on the front lines. They're more than happy to focus on our performance and the little news we have from home, the contents of which is sometimes a source of entertainment as well. As we travelled, there were fewer and fewer green spots, with the brown fields almost stretching into one with no barriers between them, with very few buildings left standing. There were a few small farm buildings which had been obviously flattened, with small outlines of what was there before being the only sign that there had been a building there in the first place. We've had to get out of the vehicle in order for us to get rescued and for it to be easy to get out of this divot in the ground. The mud is thick and we've been instructed to stay on the road. There's still barbed wire in the deeper mud, we've been told. A plane has just passed overhead. I hope it's one of ours. We're all fighting the same, even those of us at home who are doing their part too. Those at home who were doing their part too. Down the road from us, we had a satellite airfield from the Solent region where planes would come if they needed fixing. And my grandfather, he was a sort of engineer, I guess. Anyway, he was technically minded his whole life and he worked in a local electronics shop in Midhurst. My grandparents were the first people in Midhurst to own a microwave. There were all of the other little things as well, like the electroshocking devices. Well, technically they're crystal sets. Now what you do is you wind a little handle really fast while someone holds on to a pair of handles. It's more of an electric shock, like a static shock than anything else. So it's more of a prank than anything serious. We used to take them out to collectors' evenings, and I remember Grandad semi-fleecing people into trying them out. It's one of my favourite memories. It's always a bit showy, but it's a lot. It's always a bit showy, but there's so much in my head of him. It's just remembering all of it that's the difficulty.
Every Friday on the farm is rabbit pie day. So every Friday that ever comes along.
We stopped a performance due to the noise of the bombing nearby. We didn't want to, but what's the point if no one can hear you? It did slightly surprise me how close to the front line we were, but I knew we were far enough away to be safe. We're having to postpone until later, or until it's quiet enough to perform. We were supposed to be stationed here for a few days anyway, and we don't need to rush off, so we settled in fine. We're going to be moving on after this towards Belgium. There's often a lot of time on these journeys, so there's a lot of time for peace and quiet then anyway. It gives a lot of time for thinking. I'm not sure whether it's a good thing for us all to be stuck thinking for a while. George Formby, yes, that George Formby, seems to be enjoying the time by writing music. The rest of us seem introspective. I think we're all missing home a lot. Although some of the places we've visited, like France, seem familiar, there's still something missing. We've been reminiscing about what we've done and occasionally doing small, relaxed run-throughs of what we're doing next. We've been talkative, but generally we've been wanting to be quiet. Very quiet. Quiet, like super quiet. It's in the middle of nowhere. The nearest street light is 15 minutes drive away, so it's very peaceful. You can barely hear the sound of the main road, so it's just you and the sounds of nature. It's nice. It's a nice break from the busyness of my life elsewhere. It's usually a holiday or time off when I'm at home. There are things that break this quiet though. Usually it's the cats knocking something off somewhere or the ghosts being a bit mischievous. Long story, years ago, well it is quite a few years ago, my house used to be a Victorian dame school. A Victorian dame school is where two of the older women of the village look after the children while their parents are at work or whatever. One day, there were two kids, a brother and a sister, playing near the well, near to the garden. One of them kind of fell in. The other one tried to help, but fell in too. They both died. We've heard them about a couple of times, most notably my mum when we were very, very little. We also found this diary, it's dated December 1943, so it's old as well. The detailed performances and touring and a performer doing their thing. It means a lot to me, hearing stories from performers past. Hearing stories from hearing stories from music halls and shows gone wrong have really been encouraging, especially if something doesn't quite go right on stage. It's been refreshing moving around and seeing other human beings than just the group, though. The men seem to brighten up the moment we arrive anywhere and seem to clamour to get to us. We're under strict instruction not to go too overboard on seeming affectionate, though. We've had a message from head office that officers think we're being a bit too friendly sometimes, and none of us don't want to be seen as too friendly to them, in case some unsavoury behaviour is encouraged. Watching them interact has been some experience. They've been through a lot together, and the fact that they can still laugh and joke around with each other like nothing's happening is incredible. The way they react to each other and have a camaraderie that's difficult to explain. It's incredibly difficult sometimes to... It's incredibly difficult sometimes to really know where my love of history came from. There's so many things that come to mind. One of them being the Victorian dress-up days we used to have at primary school. It always somehow tied into what we were learning, though, so I don't quite know how that worked. Anyway, one of our teachers would put on a jacket when she was in her Victorian persona and then take it off when she was explaining something to us. It just sort of grabbed my imagination, you know? There were all of the other little things we used to do at primary as well. All of the little plays and things that we put on for our families occasionally. And of course, like every good Church of England school pupil knows, the Nativity. I always wanted to be an angel. Anyway, I remember one year when I was very littler than I am now, I had this little green pedal car and I had to pedal it up to the front of the church and ask for petrol from someone there. It's always kind of stuck with me. I've always been proud of it, despite it only being a 5-second thing. TV has always been an influence too. Horrible histories, in particular. Educational and entertaining. Sign me up. Also, Matt Bainton. Anyway, there's always been the performativeness that's always kind of captured me. I've always felt something with me, like I'm being watched, but it's not malevolent. Almost like a sister soul is kind of the best way I can kind of describe it. It's kind of been pushing me to do more and checking in and making sure I'm all right. I feel like it's partly what pushed me to do all of this plays and stuff. And I remember going to the local amateur dramatic society and just loving being up on that stage. It's where I'd learned how to sing.
Where I learned how to dance.
Where we learned how to perform. Now I go window cleaning to earn an honest bob. For a nosy parker it's an interesting job. Now it's a job that just suits me. A window cleaner you would be if you could see what I could see when I'm cleaning windows. When I'm cleaning windows. When I'm cleaning windows. I've never really dated anyone, like properly, like not just go out for a drink and go to bed kind of dating. And the thought kind of scares me. I'm not 100% sure on what scares me, but I think it's the intimacy, like they'll actually know things about me. Like, I've got so many questions, you know? Like, how do you ask someone out? How soon is too soon? How long should you know someone before asking them out? Who has these answers for me, please? Kind of liked someone for a little while now. We met at D&D and we played every week. But things changed and I'd like to talk to them every now and then. But it feels a little bit intense thinking about it. So maybe I'll just leave it for a little while. To be honest, I am still healing from the last time a guy fucked me over, so I'm hoping you'll excuse my hesitance. He's so nice, it's almost impossible to imagine that things could go wrong. But you never know. Things used to be simpler, right? Right? You just used to be able to go up and say hello.
Sits at home and looks glum. He started on fretwork, he painted the bar. But mother sat in it, we did not love. Her father was out in.
I wish I could just go up and say hello. He'd been looking at me across the mess hall for a little while now. It was a little bit distracting, but in a way, I appreciated it. We'd sat down to have some supper before performing in the evening, and I just glanced up to see him looking. There was something about him, the way his eyes glinted ever so slightly in the dim lighting. After we'd had our supper, the officer in charge introduced us to the person who would be showing us around for the evening, where we'd need to go. And it just happened to be the young gentleman sat across the room from us. We might have exchanged how to get letters to each other. There are only a few people who send me letters, and so it'll be nice to get some from other people than my family and my nan. It would be nice to get some letters other than just from my family and my nan. I've got probably 50 of them in my room. My nan is the last one left, so it's a lot for me. All of her letters end the same. Kisses from Jasper, the cat. I treasure them all. As you know, my grandfather, you know what he did during the war, he did the plane and stuff. But I think the rest of my grandparents were just a bit too young to be doing anything like that. My Nana was evacuated. She was moved from London down to Midhurst with all of her family, I think. I think my granny, she might have still been in Dudley. I think, I'm not 100% sure. I just haven't heard any stories of where she was at the time. And my final grandparent, my granddad on my mum's side, Bear. He was living in Liverpool at the time. And so they were offered a boat over to Canada, but they had to do a sort of a test first to get the tickets. They flunked the test on purpose. They just saw what would happen if they failed and They didn't get their tickets. The boat was sunk halfway across the Atlantic. It's a lot, isn't it, thinking about it? The butterfly effect. Now, the smallest of decisions can affect everything. Like, if I hadn't have left home, would I have met someone? Met someone who I have slowly grown to care about. It isn't much, but our small amount of correspondence has really helped me think ahead. I haven't really had a lot of free time over the past few weeks, with our performances and rehearsals being a focus, these letters being a nice break from the drama back home. We've all been talking about news from home and how much is going to change before we go back to England. David's father has a new tractor from the Ministry of Agriculture to help out on the farm and boost productivity. Emily's brother has just finished school and is planning on signing up and coming out here. He's got a few more years before he can properly, but he's planning on it. He must be part of the Home Guard at the moment. Well, that's what we've deduced anyway. My sister now wants to start training to become a nurse rather than work as a land girl. But father doesn't want her to. He doesn't want her moving away from home like I have. I suppose he's worried of her getting into trouble. I've always been told I'm the more responsible one. I've been trusted with... I've been trusted with the biggest, fluffiest dog in existence. He was a rescue from Romania and the biggest, fluffiest creature you have ever seen. We hung out for most of the weekend and we went on little walks around the site. It was great fun. We entered the dog competitions for both days. He didn't get any from the official judges, but he got my prize for fluffiest dogger of the weekend. It was also that weekend that I got to drive my first tractor and steer my first roller. Considering it was the weekend of the ambulance's issues, I'm really glad they let me continue on with what I was planning to do. Everyone on site had had breakdowns before, so I guess they understood, really. Anyway, it's most of the people I know that I have met through history and reenactment and old vehicles. Can affect who I pick on Tinder, though. If you've got a classic car or a vintage car in your photos, I'm in. Years ago, my parents met someone else who has a military landy. She is a wire lifter instead of an ambulance, so she's lightweight. Anyway, we call this guy Uncle Andy, purely because he looked after the ambulance when my dad broke his collarbone. Skipping. With a tractor tow rope in the middle of a field, in the middle of an arena, with a watching paying audience. Like, whose dad does that? Whose dad skips, for a starter? Anyway, hang on, where was I? Yes, Uncle Andy. Anyway, he's got this gorgeous new vehicle called Gracie May, and she is beautiful. She's kitted out to be a USO truck, really. The USO being the American version of our ENSA. Now, ENSA are the National Entertainers Service Association, which is a tongue twister why we call it ENSA. Now, we find little leaflets occasionally. Well, Dad does. Dad pays for them. They're technically not mine, but I say they're mine. Anyway, we buy these leaflets online, and they come in a massive pack, and we flick through them just to see what's in there. Most of the time, it's just Sergeant Smith's field band. Bit vague, but sometimes, every so often, we find a name. It's usually someone like Gracie Fields, George Formby, that kind of thing. And I enjoy looking at them. I feel a connection, I feel a pull. So all of these names, I don't know where they're really from. I don't know really who they were, but felt a connection. And it's such a recognisable music as well. Everyone recognises the music from this time, and it's just completely different. It's just a completely different flavour of music.
Now imagine me in the Maginot Line, sitting on a mine in the Maginot Line. Now it's turned out nice again, the army life is fine. At night myself to sleep I sing.
Such different music. And it's all for what they call big bands, and they sing about places that sound so exotic. There's Trinidad, Chicago, and Texas, and all sorts of other places. They're so full of spirit as well. Their music seems far more lively than ours. It's a whole different flavour of music and feeling. Maybe it's because they just got here. Anyway, the soldiers I've met also have the same view on things. They arrived about a week ago from New York, and they're very exciting. They've got so many different things about them, the accent being one of the few. Anyway, we're performing soon, so I'd better get ready.
There's a garden, what a garden. Only happy faces bloom there, and there's never any room there for a worry or a gloom there. And there's music, and there's dancing, and a lot of sweet romancing. When they play the polka, they all get in the swing.
We've just performed our best show yet. We're visiting a field hospital this week, and we've been performing for those who are resting and healing after they've been on the Maginot Line. They're amazing, telling us stories as we go around visiting each bed in turn. Vera has been the most popular by far with pretty much all of them. Her music has a further reach than all of us really understand, I think. Mr. Formby always goes down well, but his wife is a bit disagreeable. She's wanting to get involved with anything, and it doesn't seem like she's far away at any time. It does get a bit awkward sometimes. She comes in and distracts him when we're rehearsing, and it causes all sorts of trouble. But today, at the hospital, she's been more amicable. It's more than any of us expected, and we were only visiting the minor injuries wards. Anyway, today went so well, and we're already travelling on to our next show. Going to the next show, where I'm hoping to learn a bit more about reenactment and historical accuracy. They just know so much about everything, and if you have a question, they probably have an answer for you. I do have a lot of questions about costuming, though. You know, I'm not exactly going into fit into 1940s sizes, so I've been struggling a little bit with getting a costume together. Now, I've been planning on getting my mum's sewing machine out to make my own stuff, and I've got all of the images and plans that I need. I've also been looking into who was with Ensa a bit more as well, seeing who's behind the scenes a little bit. Now, there's a very special cemetery in Portsmouth, just near the coast. It's a fairly unassuming place. I'm pretty sure we used to go past it on the way to the Isle of Wight ferry. Anyway, it's of a very special ENTSA member. Vivian Hull was a performer with ENTSA, joining in 1944 or 43, when she was only 18. She auditioned at the Drury Lane Theatre, which were the ENTSA headquarters in London, and she was soon deployed. I read her name and felt, similarly to the programmes, I felt a pull. There was something about her name that really caught me and drew me into it. It's such a strange feeling. Such a strange feeling knowing that letters between yourself and another person could be read by someone unintended. It's made me much more careful with what I put into them. I've been following the guidance given out by the officers before we even came out here. But even so, Vera's letters going home getting intercepted has shaken us all a bit. At least she's only been talking about the games we've been playing around the lamps on our evenings off. Someone brought cards from home and we've been playing games with them. Unfortunately, some of us don't really know how to play, so we've just been stacking them into towers. The orders of what we can and can't put into our letters have been incredibly clear on what we can and cannot safely say. And I'm glad we've all been sticking to them, or we'd been in a lot of trouble by now, either from the higher-ups or the other side. But being around people who are professionals in their field has really opened my eyes to what life could be like if I continue dancing after all of this is over. Relaxing with everyone after the shows has given me the chance to think about whether this is the right thing for me to do. I'm confident that this is what I need to do when the war is over. There's rumours that Vera is going to be in a film soon and she's needing to take some time off to do that. Might leave me some more things to do around the performances, but that's fine. I prefer being on stage compared to just hanging around backstage. It doesn't feel like... It doesn't feel like my mind is my own anymore. There's things in here that I don't remember or shouldn't remember, and feels like there's two people in here. There's the me who wants to be here and present and engaging. And then there's the me who has all of these memories and things that I shouldn't remember. There's memories of performing in fields with wooden stages and uniforms. And there's getting stuck in mud with a warning of barbed wire in the mud, but I have never been in a place like that. It makes me feel a little bit overloaded, if I'm honest. Just a lot of things I shouldn't remember. I think I just have a different view on things sometimes. The incident with the ambulance was a fairly easy fix, thankfully. A half shaft, fairly easy to fix, and it doesn't take long to. Slightly simpler than some things. I think there's a lot of misconceptions around older vehicles as well. I think a lot of people either think they're really, really complicated to work with, or they're really, really simple. It's a happy medium, I think. Some things are harder, obviously. The steamroller sprung a leak halfway through the first day of the event. And, of course, being a steam vehicle, it needed to completely cool down before they could fix anything. Spent all night waiting for it. But they plugged it in the morning and she was absolutely fine. The ambulance was a slightly easier fix. Just a couple of weekends and some good old-fashioned elbow grease, particularly, well, more from Dad. He showed me how to do it, and hopefully she'll be fine for another 16 years. Oops. I think it's just how I work. It's either me just being a bit weird in general, or just growing up around such gorgeous machines that my opinion is a bit different. Learning how to fix them. Learning how to fix them has been an experience. Seeing Her Majesty the Princess driving the ambulances around London, I've been getting some lessons from one of the mechanics we have travelling with us. He's been giving me some instruction on how to fix some of the issues we might face out in the field. And I think he's been rather amused by the few of us who have been interested in learning. I'm not sure if he's just humouring us because he thinks that we're not going to be serious about it, or whether he's really interested in tutoring us in mechanical workings. There's a small difference in people's reactions. I think there's a split between the surprise that young ladies want to get a little bit oily and learn something that the men are usually doing. I think since the suffragettes fought for our rights, men should expect us to be more open to doing more jobs. We're now travelling towards the north of France, towards the top line that carries on around the top of the country. Most of us are going to be travelling in one truck, while I'll be travelling with Edward, one of our set builders. We're going to be travelling this evening, possibly into the night, as we've got some way to go before we perform in a few days' time. I'm hoping that we don't take too long, as I've got some letters to post once we get there. Yes, Mother, I'm still talking to him. I'm not sure when I'll see him again, but maybe sometime soon. We're also working on some new material as we travel around. It's all very exciting. I can't let any of it out, but it's looking like it's going to be a hit. I've also managed to gain some attention from a film director who's working on some new films in the next few years. Theory's already worked with him, so I know he's a good egg, really. There's so much that we've got planned now. When I'm home, it won't be for long. Love to Father, Margaret, and the dog. Vivian Hole and her driver died that night. They took a wrong turn at a fork in the road and they hit a minefield. They were killed instantly. She was only 19, less than 6 months after she joined. Being 19 when we found her story, it really hit me and stuck with me. There's so many stories that haven't been told by the unknown people, and I want to tell them. There's so many people who didn't fight with a gun that I think we should remember more than we do. There's the timber jills, the land girls, the doctors, the nurses, the ambulance drivers. And the stories I want to tell most of all are the unknown stories of entertainers. They brought us such light in the dark times. And so I think I want to tell their stories now. Wish me luck as you wave me goodbye. Here I go. Here I go on my way. Wish me luck
as you wave me goodbye. With a cheer, not a tear, make it gay. Give me a smile I can keep for a while in my heart while I'm away. Till we meet once again, you and I. Wish me luck as you wave me goodbye.